I've been seeing you on YouTube for quite a while, and doing your stuff on your end, all the amazing educational stuff. There was one particular video that I actually recommend to my students that you made, is the almost like 5 or 6 parts music for dancers part. And I'm a musician, and before even dancing, and I was always had that question in my head: what information is pertinent to give to a dancer or like a recreational dancer, not to get into the weeds and talk about rhythm and stuff like that. And I'm not at all a master in Latin music, but I really enjoyed the way you do it. It must have been extremely time consuming, and it's very laid out to the point where I make cr also material like that, to the point where it was so good that I didn't want to do one. I was like, this is top of the heap, top of the food chain. Was really well made and was very progressive and very thoughtful. And the way you explained things, it was perfect for a beginner and intermediate dancer or somebody that has problems with rhythm. So I do recommend that series. And I don't know how much time it took you to do that. Maybe you can speak on the process.
Sure. First of all, thanks for having me. I've seen you on YouTube for a long time as well, so it's cool to actually connect here and chat. So thanks for that. I think you're talking about the Finding the Beat series, and that was actually the series that I did to get started on YouTube, because before that, just posting kind of demos of our lessons. So I wanted to put my face out there and talk more and like you said, give some education and talk about the things that a lot of teachers aren't talking about in their classes, and they're just hoping that people understand how to find the beat. But I think it's like the biggest challenge for beginners, like you
It
said.
is.
So it was the first set of videos I did, and luckily for me, I have a pretty logical way of thinking. So I just kind of sat down and I said, okay, I know nothing about salsa music. How do I explain to someone how to get there? And so I'd kind of gone through this process, because I used to be a b-boy, like a break dancer.
That's
So I'd
awesome.
gone through this process with simple music, like pop music, hip hop music, rock music, like that has a very simple beat. The instruments are simple. There's no crazy syncopated rhythms. So I basically just said, how would I do this if it was simple music? And so that's what step one and step two were. Step one was just like, hey, let's understand what is tempo, what are beats, what is phrasing, just basic musical vocabulary with easy music. And then how do we move our bodies to just simple music, stamping our fingers, clapping our hands, stepping side to side. And then okay, now that you can move to simple music, let's learn the more complicated music, salsa, what's different about it. And then that was step three, just talking about the music, and using the same concepts as the first part. And then move on, how do we move to that music now that we're starting to understand it? So just like a really step-by-step process.
Do you think that the reason we don't go there, because I feel a bit of pressure when I start talking about music, I feel that after the 5th minute, like some people want to do moves, they're here to dance. So I'm trying to kind of do it, but like here and there, mostly in starting an intermediate level. And I also had always a problem to understand when somebody does not have the beat or understanding of the beat. Like I remember one of my teachers said, "Can you tap the foot? It's like a heartbeat. Can you just keep tapping the foot?" And some people have a hard time just keeping steady with their hands. And I'm wondering if that skill in or if you encountered you probably encountered students like that, but did you ever feel that you could teach somebody to be constant? Or it's just like something, it's like a DNA strain missing somewhere. I really don't know. I don't know what's your experience with that.
I think that's a great question, because the question there is really are people born with talent or can they learn things? And from my experience and from the books I've read, it's 100% anyone can learn anything pretty much at any age. And yeah, certain things might be able to be learned or absorbed earlier, as a child, but anyone can really learn anything at any point. And that's important to tell people, because there's this myth or this belief that they're like, oh, I didn't learn it when I was a kid. I have 2 left feet, or I can't find a beat. I can't clap my hands. I'm screwed. And I'm never going to be able to do it. And so I think the first thing is to change that belief, because if someone doesn't believe they can do something, they'll never do it. So
100%.
you gotta switch that. And so can you teach someone to, stay on beat that they can't stay on beat right now? Absolutely. And I think The reason they can't stay on beat right now is because one, they have no confidence. They think, I don't know anything. What is this music? It's foreign to me. So you have to make it familiar to them. So explaining, like, even just the basic musical vocabulary, like, hey, tempo, you know, is the speed of the music. You know, this is the instrument you're hearing. This is how it's played. And so, and, you know, especially with salsa music, like, people trying to find the one, and a lot of the instruments that people talk about, like, oh, the clave is the key to salsa music. And you're like, sure, the clave is important for musicians and, you know, dancers who are a bit more advanced, but to find the one for a beginner, the clave is probably the most complicated thing that you could probably introduce to them. I think something more simple, like the piano, because the piano is going to play in kind of that nice 8-beat or 16-beat phrase, that loop. And you can just go to the, you know, salsabeatmachine.org, click on the piano and hear it. And you can tell your student, look, when this phrase repeats, it's marking the one.
Right. Yep.
One. And so that's much easier to clue into. And so as soon as you give people a couple tips on what can they focus on, all of a sudden they're easier to kind of find that beat and then find the one, you know, because the first step is just like, hey, do I know where the beat is and I'm not just going like this? And then can I identify which one of those beats is the one?
What do you think are the elements? Like, I was wondering, because let's say you get a group of students that are beginners, and some of them right off the bat are on beat, and others, even after, let's say, six classes, or I don't know, two sessions of 20 classes, they're still struggling for that. Do you attribute that to something in their, like, I'm wondering, like, not to go against the fact that everybody can learn something. I'm just thinking, it's just like what makes somebody on beat right off the bat? Is there a musical knowledge? Is it just perception of time? What do you think?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. And I think it goes back to, you know, the first question you asked, and I didn't address this because you're talking like about in-person classes right now, being a teacher, teaching a group of students. And like you're saying, everyone's at different levels. Some people might have a musical background. Some people might have danced before. There's going to be people in the class that have never listened to music before and never danced before, and they're trying to take this step and get uncomfortable and push their comfort zone and do something new. So everyone's at a different level. So how do you manage that as a teacher? That's very difficult. I have less experience doing that in a salsa context in person with a big group of students. And that's one of the reasons why I really like the online lessons. And so that's why I started the Dance Dojo, is because not everyone's getting what they need in the moment in the salsa class. Because there's one teacher and, I don't know, 20, 30, 40 students, who knows, depends how big the room is. And so not everyone can get what they need in that moment. And as a teacher, you might be able to give each person what they need, but to give everyone what they need in the same moment is that challenge of having that physical space and limited time. So the way I solved that problem is creating a tool online so someone can come home after salsa class and be like, I can't find the beat, or I'm struggling with that. And so they can just click play on YouTube and watch the series of videos. So I think there's certain things that can be done well in a class setting and other things that work better in kind of like a supplementary context, like coming home, practicing online, doing it by myself, because a lot of people are going to be uncomfortable when they're being watched, especially when they're doing something new and they're not getting it right away, right? So if you get it right away, you're going to be confident. You're going to be the star of the class. You feel great. If you're not the one that's getting it right away, you're going to feel really self-conscious and be like, oh, this isn't for me. I don't know how to do it. But then if you give them this tool that they can just go home and dig in, because a lot of these people might be introverts as well, then they can up their understanding. And as soon as they start to understand, then their confidence comes up, and then they're going to show up to the class and be like, hey, like, I kind of know how to do this now. And they're going to feel more comfortable. So sometimes class is great. Sometimes being at home alone or just being online is the way to do it. So it's a bit of a mix. And I think both are great.
Do you have, like, you speak like somebody that been studying how to teach? Do you have any education background, any interest in that? Where does that come from?
That's a good question. So I don't have any formal education in teaching, but when I was in like grade one, I was like good at math and numbers in school and stuff. So I remember like helping my friends with, you know, coursework right away, especially math. And so through my life, I've always had a love for being a student. I like learning. And then the things that I learned, I love to share that with other people. And I guess it's probably just a little bit of my nature, like how I was born, like the kind of personality I am. So I'm introverted, so I'm gonna listen more than I speak most of the time. And I guess that's kind of given me a bit of an empathy or a gift of empathy. So I'm more easily to pick out, I listen to someone and say, this is the part that they're not understanding. How can I give them that little nugget that's gonna get them to the next level of understanding so that they can get further on their journey? And so I guess I've done that with schoolwork.
Sorry.
Nice cat. No, it's okay.
Sorry, go ahead.
I kind of did that with school. And then I was a competitive diver from 10 years until 15 years old.
Are you serious?
I went to Montreal when I was diving as well.
No way. That's awesome.
Yeah. So I was a diver and then I was a dive coach for 5 years. And wow. Then I quit diving when I was 15. And I decided I want to break dance.
Why? What made the switch?
So I was training 5 days a week, 3 hours a day, plus weights on some days. So that was a lot of time. And I was getting I had a thumb injury because I was diving from the 10 meter platform. And if you don't enter the water with completely completely straight arms, you can sometimes hit yourself in the head with your hand.
Oh my God. I can't just imagine.
It's not fun. You're hitting the water at like 33 kilometers an hour. So that's like hitting your thumb on a brick. Like it hurts. I mean, your head's pretty hard. So I did that too many times and I had this thumb brace. And you know, naturally in like elite level competition or training, like your coaches are not always so empathetic in terms of time off and give you time to rest. So my thumb started to really hurt. It got to a point where I wasn't enjoying myself. And the next year, it wasn't just going to be 5 times a week, the training. It was going to be 6 times a week, twice a day, like, hey, we're going for the Olympics sort of thing.
Jesus.
And as a 15, 16 year old, I wasn't enjoying myself. I was like, you know what? I'm enjoying this breakdance thing that I've been doing for a while. Like, I just want to have fun with my friends. So
this intense training, do you feel that is just too much for any kind of human? Like I always hear stories where there's a lot of pressure and like at some point to get to the elite level, it's like you're almost sacrificing your body for the sport or something like that. Do you feel that it's actually unhealthy at the end of the day, physically and mentally, or there's something to it? Am I missing something?
I think there's certain approaches that are better than others. And every coach is going to kind of have their specialty, but like, it doesn't matter what sort of elite level training you're doing, it's going to push you to your limit and then beyond that, because you need to keep expanding what you're capable of. Right. And so that's actually an important takeaway from elite level training is you have to always be at the edge of your comfort zone and be pushing that. Mm-hmm. Because even as a salsa dancer, if you're not doing that, you're either going to improve super slowly or you're not going to improve at all. And so it's really important to work on the edge of the comfort zone and constantly be pushing it. Do I think it's unhealthy? No, I think they're just like any way of doing something. There's kind of more healthy ways and there's like, let's call them toxic ways. That's the word everyone
but I mean,
uses
but
these
I mean,
days.
You were at the extreme of training. Like there's training and there's trainings. Like there's recreation, competition, and then there's the Olympics. Like it's like another level of sacrifice. And then performance becomes the focus. Right. Mm-hmm. So do you think like exactly like you said, maybe the coaches weren't as understanding?
I think it's a bit of everything. So for me, I decided, look, my love for this was kind of dying. What I really enjoyed from it was like the physical challenge. I love doing acrobatics, you know, seeing if I could figure these things out and then executing them well. I like challenges and I realized I like to work hard. So it taught me how to train. And is it demanding? Absolutely. If you're a person who likes to challenge yourself, it's great. If you're competitive, it's great. If you're not a competitive person, whether like in group team sports or against yourself, you probably won't enjoy it. So you'd probably never get to that level. So it's going to pick out the people who really excel at doing that.
Makes sense.
And then yes, you do have to make sacrifices because you're training every day instead of playing with your friends. So
Got it.
Yeah.
And the switch from to b-boying, did you approach b-boying the same way you were training as a diver?
That was funny because I have this like distinct memory of like when you're in your dive training, like I wasn't quite to the point where we were getting super specific with nutrition, but it was like, hey, like you should take care of your body, da da da. And so like before an event the next day, like, hey, like, eat something nice, like don't go crazy. And I remember starting to break down. It's like, oh, I can just chill with my friends and eat pizza before the battle. It doesn't matter, you know? Like, there's no rules. You had no coach. You could do whatever you wanted. And that was part of the beauty, the freedom. It was like, I didn't have the trainer anymore, and I could just be. And that was the attractiveness of
that switch. But were you training as hard? Like, did you have that mindset of like a Olympic trainer guy, or you just literally... like how shall I say this? You took it more like now it's we're having fun, we're more laid back, less pressure. Did you change your mindset right away or no?
That's a good question. I think I had the discipline from diving and training, but I wouldn't say I kept that level of training because it was a lot. But what I tried to do is we had some like group practices at community centers like once or twice a week, so I'd go there. But then I was also really lucky. In my mom's place, we had like a kind of a basement area, like carpeted. So we grabbed these mirrors from her old office and just put them against the wall. So I kind of had this mini studio. It was a carpeted floor, but it's still better than nothing. So I'd go down there most days and just be by myself in front of a mirror and mess around and film myself. And that's when I really started to level up. And actually, this is a good parallel to salsa, is that that was when I actually learned how to dance, because a lot of b-boys, a lot of b-girls, breakdancers, they're all about the moves, they're all about the power moves, learning tricks, and they suck at dancing. If you put on a song and you're like, hey, just chill and groove to this music, a lot of them suck at that. And so at that moment, I had actually watched some dancers that were really much better than us, that I really looked up to, Massive Monkeys from Seattle. They're a famous b-boy crew. And I watched them and said, what do they have that I don't? And I'm like, they have this character, they have this feeling, they know how to dance. And it's like, okay, I need to learn how to dance. And so I'd go down into the basement every day in front of the mirrors and just like start figuring it out. And when you just dance on your feet in breaking, it's called top rocking. So I would just top rock dance on my feet, no tricks, no nothing on the ground, and just spending hours in front of the mirror. And this is the same thing in salsa, is like, you're here and you want to get here. So you feel really good when you dance, but you look terrible. That's how everyone starts, okay? Or maybe you feel terrible and you look terrible. But then eventually you're like, oh, this kind of feels good, but it looks bad. And you want to get to the point where everything feels good and looks good. But to close that gap, you have to get the visual feedback from the mirror or filming yourself. So what feels good eventually also looks good. And that just comes with repetitions in front of the mirror, in front of a camera. So you can be like, oh, like that felt good, but hey, it kind of looked weird. So I want to take that feeling that I had and just adjust how it actually looked or how I'm executing
it. It's interesting. So you start from a feeling point, right? Mm-hmm. That's very interesting that you start how it feels or it should feel. How, like, let's say you do something, it feels good. Then you film yourself and you look at it and you go, damn. Man, I was drunk.
It's happened to all of us.
It was odd because I had a teacher that used to say, it was an African dance teacher. He said, I hate working with mirrors. And I'm like, I'm coming from the salsa world, right? So I'm like, mirrors, we only know mirrors. And goes, no, it makes people feel too subconscious. I want them to let loose and dance their heart out. I'm thinking, wow, okay. I never even that thought crossed my mind that people will constrict in front of mirrors. And I started to, now I don't train any troops, but before I was training troops, I used to spin them around all the time just so they don't get attached to the room, right? So just sometimes do it in front of mirror, sometimes at the back of the mirror. And it's odd how different somebody might dance if he watches himself, if he's self-critical. It all depends how you use information, right? So if you're looking at yourself, you know, he's like, oh, I'm not looking good at it. And at the same time, you're dance that kind of attitude. Then the coach will look at you and go, listen, relax, breathe, extend your motions and stuff like that. But it's very interesting that you start from a feeling and then you video and then you're trying to accomplish, I guess, with some kind of a method to look the part, right? And what do you do with, how should I say this? So what do you do if somebody is self-critical like that? Like he can't use the information properly. Like I dealt with that so many times, and every time is a bit different how I approach the person to mellow her out. How would you deal with that?
Yeah, I think it's a really cool question because it's important. And I think it depends on the person's level. Because, like you said, at first, they're going to be probably uncomfortable. They have no confidence. They don't really know what they're doing. So you don't want to encourage them to be self-critical too quickly, right?
Yeah, you're right.
And this reminds me of this. I love this example. I used to, well, I still follow this girl named Amber Ray, and I did a mastermind group with her actually. And she's this artist, she's a writer, and she brought up these two personalities, or there's a couple more, but these two are important in this context.
What is master what? What did you say?
A mastermind group.
What is that?
It's kind of like a group where everyone's coming together and focusing on a certain topic. So it could be a
Okay.
mastermind around business, improving your
Got it.
business, or
Got it.
this was with creative entrepreneurs. And so she talked about this artist role and this editor role. And they're both important, but you have to know when to be each one. So for the beginners, I think it's really good, especially if someone's like, I don't want to move, I'm uncomfortable, like I didn't grow up with music or dance. Like at first, they don't need a mirror. Like you just want to get that person moving, like literally just like shake their body and like make them do weird stuff so that they stop being afraid to actually just move. Like they don't need to move correctly in any way. Just move your body so you're stop being afraid of moving your body. And so you're in the artist role. You're not critiquing, you're just creating. You're just being weird, that's fine. And then there comes a point where it's important now I have to edit what the artist created and start thinking like, "Hey, is that really how I want to move? Is that our goal? Is that my goal?" And so I think if someone's afraid to move, take away the mirrors. Get them moving, like literally just shaking. It doesn't even have to be like some sort of get them moving. And then after they got rid of that fear, then we're like, okay, let's change how we're moving now. Let's edit that. And so that I guess would be my best response.
Very good point. Very good point. I think it's key. It's to tailor the intervention, and also if the mirror is a stopper at that point, especially at the beginner level, just to get him moving and just get him moving for crying out loud. Just move. I had I wanted to start with this question, and then we went into other interesting topics. But as soon as I saw that you're living in Medellin, is this the Pablo Escobar Medellin?
Yeah, Medellin is where Pablo Escobar is from,
Okay,
but
so
it is so much more than Pablo.
I don't want it to reduce it to that because I'm just a big fan of the series, and I made a couple of spoof with that. But I wanted to know first of all, what do you do? Like, what's your main gig over there? And also, what brought you there? You came from Toronto, correct?
I'm actually from Victoria, Canada, and then moved to
Victoria.
Vancouver.
Got it.
But
And so you went to I don't know why I was thinking Toronto. So Vancouver, and then from Vancouver you went to Medellin. And you've been living there for how many years?
It's kind of been on and off since 2017, so it's like 3.5 years total. Been bouncing around South America.
What's bringing you in that region?
So I was at like a really low point in my life before I came here. So I was going through my life and analyzing like what were my highs, what were my lows. And one of those highs was during university, and I went to Singapore on an exchange. There was like 300 exchange students from all over the world. I was traveling, it was awesome. One of the things I realized when I was there is the Europeans all spoke like 4 or 5 languages, and I felt really stupid. So I told myself, "Hey, Robin, when you go home, you're learning a second language, and that's that." And I'd taken like 2 Spanish classes in high school, which erased all the French that I learned as a child, because in Canada we have to learn French. But because I'm from the West, you're from the French part, so you speak French, obviously. My French was erased. And so I had that Spanish, and I liked the way Spanish sounds, so I started learning Spanish. Then I was like, okay, I'm not enjoying the relationship I'm in right now. I'm not enjoying my job. And my mom was also sick with cancer. So there's just like all these different sides of my life, like in a low point. So I said, what do I really want to do? How can I recreate this high of being in a different spot in the world and this sort of exchange experience I had? So I said, okay, well, I'm learning Spanish. So, maybe South America. I don't know South America. Where am I going to go? I asked people, what are your favorite countries? Everyone told me Colombia and Brazil. Colombia speaks Spanish. Brazil speaks Portuguese. So, okay, I'm going to go to Colombia. And so after I quit my job, I quit my relationship. Eventually, sadly, my mom passed away in 2016. That was the last thing that was kind of holding me in Canada. And it's like, okay, it's time to go. So I flew down to Colombia and I ran around the country, traveled. I really loved it. And so in 2017, I decided to move to Medellin. And what was so beautiful about this experience was it gave me the opportunity to focus on Dance Dojo. So that is the thing that I do full time. It's the online lessons at thedancedojo.com. And before I'd come to Columbia, I wasn't making enough money. Like, I wasn't earning enough money from that project. So I had to work another job. But what you probably know is when you work another job and you have your passion, your love on the side, you can't give it the energy it needs to flourish. So when I came here, the cost of living was lower. I had all my free time. And so it gave me that space to really focus on the Dance Dojo. And I was able to grow it to the point where I'm comfortable now and I can live off it. And so that's what I'm doing full time.
Man, good for you. Bravo. Yeah. Really nice. Because it's not, I can completely feel how not easy it is to rev up an online project. As I tried in French, you know, it's a lot of work. You know, during the pandemic, yeah, I did a little French site. Mm-hmm. Man, it's a lot of work. If people think they're going to flock like a gold rush, no way, Jose. No, that's not how it works.
Entrepreneurship is hard. Yes.
Oh, my God. My God. We have to love it or else we would be doing something else. And exactly. So right now it's your full-time thing in Medellin. And you said on and off. You mean you traveled the continent? How what did you do?
Yeah, so this is like me trying to figure out what I want to do with my life. So I came to Medellin in 2017 for 4 months.
Got it.
And I was living with my best friend at the time. And after 4 months, it was like, okay, like I kind of lived here. It was summer in Canada. So I was like, this is the best time to go home and visit. So I went back to Canada, visited for the summer. And I didn't really have a life plan. So I was like, okay, well, I guess I'll stick around to have an apartment in Vancouver for a while. And then the friend that I was living with here in Medellin came and visited me in Vancouver. This would have been like fall of 2017. And he's like, hey, like, winter, like let's get out of here, let's go back. And so I came back in late 2017 and 2018 for 8 months. And then after those 8 months, it's like, okay, like I love Medellin, my Spanish is getting better, I feel super comfortable, like it's easily my second home, I love it here and I love Colombia, but like what else is out there in South America? Like I wanted to get to know some other countries. So when I was actually in Canada the year before, I'd met a girl from Chile, and so she was going to be going back to Chile. So I said, like, hey, like, are you going back to Chile? She's like, yeah, like, come stay with me and my mom. So I went down to Chile and lived there for 6 months. And actually, it was a really interesting experience. It felt kind of like a Latino Canada because the landscapes are really similar. The mountains, rivers, like, super beautiful and much more developed in terms of education and all these things. So it felt way different than Colombia, especially not being around the Caribbean. Like, a lot of people imagine Latin America, I think, to be that Caribbean vibe, you know, Mexico, Cuba, you know, Colombia. And then when you go to the south, whether it's to like Chile or Argentina, it's much more European. It's going to be different, but more similar to a place like Canada, I'd say. And so I liked it. And I had to actually travel a lot. So I went up to Mexico and then Costa Rica for some friends' 30th birthdays. And so when I came back to Chile, they're like, what are you doing here? Like, do you have a job? Do you live in Canada? Like, I'm like, yes, I work in Canada. I'm not working here. They're like, do you have an exit ticket? No, I'm going to catch a bus to Mendoza in Argentina. And of course, you don't buy bus tickets like 6 months in advance. So they're like, how long are you staying here? And I said, 90 days, because that was the maximum. And this lady just kept shaking her head. And I was like, it's not easy to get into like Colombia. It's kind of more like Canada, like where they're questioning you, why are you here? And so I was like, man, like, I can't stay here. I have to go somewhere else. So I was like, oh, do I go back to Colombia? Because I was missing this vibe, this Colombian vibe, the music, the dance, this culture that I'm in love with. And I said, where else can I find that? Venezuela, not a good option at the moment. Brazil. I said, maybe I should find out why everyone loves Rio. And it felt like starting from zero because I don't speak Portuguese. But I was like, hell, screw it. I'm going to figure out why everyone loves Rio. I went to Rio for 3 months.
That's awesome.
Absolutely loved it because I grew up near the ocean and Medellin doesn't have an ocean. So it's so beautiful. Rio de Janeiro, like 100% recommend it. If anyone's going on holiday or is a digital nomad, it's a beautiful city. And Portuguese is also, if you have some Spanish or French, you can learn it pretty quickly. So that was awesome.
Wow. And are you still... how should I say this? Do you feel at home in some places, or you look at yourself as being a nomad? Are you looking for a home?
That's a great question, because before I left Canada, I had this in my mind. I had traveled and I lived in Singapore for that semester of school. I was like, can I live overseas and be happy? Because I think most people, when they're born in a place, they assume they're going to live there forever. And I think that was more common in our parents' generation. Now that's kind of changing.
Yeah.
But so that was the question, like, can I live somewhere else and be happy? And I came down to Colombia and the answer is yes. Like, you, once you get comfortable in a place, you learn the culture, you learn the language, learning the language is important.
Yeah.
The key there is, once you kind of get comfortable, you need to surround yourself with some good people. Once you find good people, you can feel at home anywhere. If you don't find some good people, you're going to be homesick. You're going to feel like you don't have any friends, because like, you need to feel that closeness with people. And so, yeah, the answer is absolutely. And so, am I a nomad? I don't consider myself so much of a digital nomad. I mean, compared to someone who always lives in Canada, I guess, yes. But I meet a lot of digital nomads who move from place to place like every month or every few weeks. And to me, that's totally exhausting. Because like, I've done that, but like every 3 months or every 6 months, like chunks at a time, like slower traveling. And I love that now, because then you can have a base, you can make some friends, you can learn the language. But then you, because you're in a new place, you can just kind of go off to all these cool destinations nearby. And I feel like that's a much more enriched experience, because I see all these people bouncing from country to country, but they don't actually see or get to know anything about those countries other than a couple touristy spots. And for me, that's not my ideal. So I've enjoyed this way of kind of...
How's the... are you involved in the salsa scene in any way in your part of the world?
So my challenge has been, and maybe this is a segue to something you want to talk about, I'm not sure, my hip. So I have some arthritis in my hip, and there's a longer story to that. So for the last few years, before the pandemic, it really started to hurt me. And that's when I moved down here the last time. So it was beginning of January 2020, right before the pandemic. I moved back to Medellin. Was only going to stay 3 months. Pandemic happened. Still here. Medellin's like home now. So I haven't danced for like 2 or 3 years, because my hip started to hurt too much. And so that emotionally hurts, like, because that already happened to me for breakdancing, because I had to quit breaking, because not because I wanted to, but because I had a hip surgery and my hip wasn't strong enough to dance anymore. So that's how I found salsa. It's like, I need to fill that gap with something else, with a little bit more calm. And so I found salsa. And so, yes, now I'm involved in the community, but kind of in a high, very integrated level. I know people here, I go to classes. I'm not teaching, but now I'm starting to dance again. So I recently put out a video on YouTube. It was like, hey, I'm back. My hip's feeling better, so I'm being able to dance again. This is what's been happening. And so I'm just a casual level. I go to socials. I go to classes. I know some people, but yeah, I'm not doing events or teaching or anything like that.
Do you still have pain? You still carry pain with you, or is it resolved?
Yeah. So to give people, the listeners, a bit of a background, when I was like 18, 19, I had a whole lot of tension in my hip flexors and my glutes, and it felt muscular and I didn't know what was going on. And this is actually a really common problem for a lot of athletes, a lot of dancers. So this might help you, some of you. And so I tried every therapy under the sun, physio, acupuncture, hot yoga, normal yoga, anything you can imagine for like 2 or 3 years, nothing helped. I just kept having this pain. I could stretch for half an hour. I'd get up, I'm stiff again. And so I don't know why, but it took about a couple of years before a specialist said like, hey, you should get an x-ray. So if you're having this chronic pain, get an x-ray, get an MRI, and get that as soon as possible, because then you can actually see what's happening. And so this x-ray showed that, hey, like, you have a hip impingement. And what does that mean? So you have your hip joint, like you have your pelvis here, and your hips rotate in that socket, right? So what it means is my impingement, I had extra bone on the head of my femur. So your femur should look like this, like the head should be nice and round and the neck should be skinny, so that you can rotate and it doesn't bump. But I had extra bone here, so every time I lifted my knee, it was going bump, 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 destroying the cartilage. And so when I finally got the surgery to remove that bone, the surgeon said like, hey, you're probably gonna get arthritis. 10 years later, here I am. I have grade 4 osteoarthritis, which means I now have osteophytes back on the head of my femur. And every time I lift my knee, it's rubbing the cartilage. I almost have bone on bone. There's almost no cartilage. So I have to replace this hip. And so,
It's both hips or just one side?
Just one side. I've had a preservation surgery on the other one, so it doesn't happen. Actually, recently, a couple months ago, because I'm always worrying about one hip. And so I asked the doctor, like, hey, maybe we should take a look at the other one just to make sure that it doesn't happen again. So we fixed that one. It should be good for the rest of my life. But I do have to replace this other side. And so I found that out last year. And since then, I've been doing physiotherapy for a few years, but I thought my situation had been resolved. I thought that bone was gone and the movement was normal. I got the x-ray again and the MRI last year, and they're like, hey, wow, this is, your hip is fucked. Like, you actually have bumps and bone there. So I went back to physio. I worked super hard. I finally found a physio team that was really good, and I've strengthened my hip now. So when I walk, it doesn't hurt. When I dance, it's, I can dance for a couple hours. It doesn't hurt. But what the problem is when you have a chronic injury or an unstable joint for a long period of time, you develop compensations in the rest of your body, because your body is always looking for symmetry. So if there's not symmetry or not strength in one side, you know, your right hip, you're going to start having these compensations in your left shoulder, and your spine's going to twist. So to undo all of that, it's very difficult. So advice to everyone, if you're having chronic pain, get x-rays, get MRIs right away, so the specialist can tell you actually what's and see what's going on inside, and then try and not let these, like, don't let it go on so long that these compensations start happening, because undoing them is very difficult. Just like learning poor salsa basics and poor salsa technique is much harder to undo. So you want to try and get it right from the start and identify problems early in your health, in your salsa.
You actually included salsa in the medical advice. My man.
Just doing my part.
All right. So, I really hope that you resolve this, because I know how, when you get injured, how screwed up it is and how emotionally intense it could be. You know, I practice Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for now 8 years. Oof. And once my neck went, like, I have a double herniated disc in my neck, had to stop almost 8 months, and postural exercises, I couldn't barely do a right turn. Like, I had to keep my neck like this. If you touch my mm-hmm. my, what's it called?
Chin.
I think I had the French word in my head. So you touch my chin, it would send shocks into my arm. So I feel you, like, it's so discouraging at times. It's so, you know, everything, it's like we take our body for granted. Let's just say how it is. You know, we're like, everything's fine. And then boom, your little finger goes off, and that's it. It's like, it stops you in your tracks. You can't eat, you know? It's
You sneeze and your spine falls apart.
Exactly. I used to sneeze like this, because when I would sneeze like this, it would stop the air and just create massive pain in my neck. So I had to sneeze with my throat open, sneeze in the air. So I'm thinking, man, I hope, like, I just hope, like, because dancing, like, I shouldn't say salsa is low impact, but Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, I'm starting to roll like an old man. So whenever the guy got my neck, I'm tapping. He goes, I didn't do anything. Yeah, you had my neck.
Yeah. You just, salute. Like this. You touched the vertebrae.
Okay. But, hey, listen, I wanted to get in, of course, a bit of YouTube. Because you've been on YouTube for quite a while, and you accelerated the pace the last year or two. And I want to know first, what made you want to start YouTube at first, even like considering opening a channel? What was your mindset? And also, what's your creation process? How do you go about creating content?
Interesting question. So why YouTube, or why did I start YouTube? So Dance Dojo was launched in 2014. And back then, I was way too nervous to actually put my face on YouTube. So what I was doing was, I was just taking all the demo videos of our lessons of Patrick and Scarlett and putting those on YouTube. So very passive, nothing super interesting, just a demo, not really instruction. And so, you know, we grew our following, but very slowly. It was nothing like this, because the videos weren't interesting. And at the same time, from a business perspective, I was realizing that everyone thought Dance Dojo was Patrick and Scarlett's business. Which is okay on some levels, but when you're trying to grow it, it's really important, especially these days, to be the face of the business, so that there's a person and someone. And if I wanted to grow that business, I realized, look, I need to put my face in front of the camera. I need to stop being behind the curtain and, you know, putting in my ideas here and there. It's like, it's gotta be, hey, this is Robin. This is what we created. I brought in these amazing teachers, but I have opinions and thoughts as well, and I can share those with you, because those teachers are usually busy, like, all the time, and so they don't have any time to do these videos. So I got to this point where it's like, okay, I want to grow this project. I want to help more people. How can I do that? I have to go outside of my comfort zone. And so I have to take my learning, but then start sharing with people. And so I decided to get in front of the camera. And actually, it was my best friend here in Medellin. His name is Miles, and he had an Amazon business. And he started a YouTube channel to start teaching people how to run Amazon businesses. And so he did it a few months before me. And so he really helped like inspire me. And so then I started. And I started with the Finding the Beat series because I just wanted like a little project to like help me get started. And that went well. And so why I started on YouTube from a business perspective is you can only control, or you can only focus on what you can control. I can't control the time and that other instructors can dedicate because this is my project. So I can control my time. So I'm going to do what I can to push the business forward. And that is create videos, lift awareness, increase marketing so that people find out what is the Dance Dojo, salsa, how do we dance salsa? And they're like, oh, I want to learn more. Go to the website, you can try the courses. And so that was kind of the business side of it. And then the salsa side of it, like how did I start going about creating content, was I asked myself, like, what are the things that I wish people were talking about more? So when I was a student, what did I wish that the teachers would have told me? And then also a lot of people would write in and say like, hey, like they had questions. So I just started asking like, what are the most frequent questions, frequently asked questions. And that's the starting point. And I think that's a great starting point for anyone, but it's not even the starting point. It's the, you know, what are the questions students are always asking? Like, let's dig in and answer those questions. And then that builds trust because you're helping people along. And when you start developing that relationship with people, then they're like, okay, well, what else do you have? And so from a business perspective, that's also very helpful.
Well, how do you balance, or do you ever balance in your head something you want to do, like something like this, okay, I want to do it almost like a gift for yourself, versus answering a need of a client? Because I always wrestled with that idea, and sometimes I would, like I did an experiment, I did a video that I wanted to do forever, like a spoof on 80s fitness. Has nothing to do with salsa, I wanted to do it. That was the video. It took me ages to do. It took me maybe between 30 hours. All in all, I scripted it. I practiced it. I did everything like the maximum. But this was more like a thing that I had in my head. It wasn't. There was no correlation with the amount of work and how well it did. It did not do well. No, regardless if it was appropriate for my channel or not. That's another discussion. But I always. It's hard for me to balance both because I have many flashes in my head. I'm thinking, okay, I want to do this, but maybe it's good, maybe it's not good. And for me, YouTube was almost like a therapy of me excluding myself, not taking the metrics too personal. Because at some point and during the pandemic, when I was very mentally stable, I was looking at metrics and I'm thinking, oh, what the fuck? And I was losing my mind sometimes because I don't know if you had that with your channel. I'm just really curious. In 2020, as soon as the pandemic started, my channel took a dip and everybody was saying, no, people are going to be interested by videos and stuff like that. And then my wife said to me, well, I don't watch videos no more. I can't go dancing. Like I used to watch videos. Now I don't watch them because usually I just watch for inspiration before going to a social and she's an amazing dancer. Yeah. But now I have no interest to do it. I don't know if there was a link or did you ever see that in your channel also or no?
Yeah, so very similar thing happened before COVID. So actually I had just started doing the YouTube videos in November, December before COVID. So what was happening was the channel was starting to grow. And then kind of like this COVID thing started to happen and everyone's like, oh my God, like I need to do something online. Like they're going crazy for just like, they don't want to be bored. And so everything like the YouTube, the sales, it kind of just went like, this is like March, April. And then just like exactly what you said, like a straight down crash to like the lowest, you know, views, sales from like three, four years ago when the business was smaller. And obviously that's heartbreaking because one, we're like, well, we're doing stuff online, but it's a partner dance and there's no more parties. And so people were just like defeated. Me and you were defeated because we're trying to push people forward, trying to push the businesses forward, trying to help people learn salsa. But the dancers were just like, I don't think I'm ever going to dance again. Yeah, and so that's true. Exactly what happened. And then slowly, of course, it's recovered. But
I'm feeling right now. And it's probably very encouraging for all of us right now. The demand for classes hasn't ever been that high, like ever in my 20 years, ever. I'm like, I'm floored. I'm thinking, I have waiting lists. I never had waiting list before. Like, it's crazy. Oh. Something like the like somebody, you know, like hibernating. They just woke up. I want to dance with people. So I'm really happy. So I think that we're on the sunny side of things for a business, right? So I'm pretty happy about that. I wanted to ask you also.
I'm stoked for you. I can't say how happy that makes me feel because I've never actually had like a studio. So that's even another level of pressure. You have rent. You know, you have this place to maintain. So I'm super happy for all the teachers that are having their classes fill up again. Like,
no, for sure. And our your business, my online business, my YouTube channel, my in-person business, we're all interconnected in that way. As much more people we get, the more people dance, regardless of which school, the better all of our reach and intentions will get accomplished, because the pandemic was murder. Like literally murder. We are basically selling, like you said, a dance that needs to dance with somebody if everybody's isolated at home. And we have the best vehicle for COVID. It's like we dance together at one foot apart, sweating our eyes. You know, it's like we have the best vehicle for COVID. It's like, how can you reconcile these things, you know? And I'm happy that people kind of mellowed out with the freaking kind of fear, or I don't know what you call it, that people understood it wasn't as bad as it was portrayed at the first year. And granted, nobody knew, you know, nobody knew, people were scared, that I understand. Like, we were actually washing our groceries and Amazon boxes the first month. In Canada, at some point you would get a ticket if you would go outside after 8. Like, I'm thinking, outside.
You should have been in Medellin.
It was worse.
You could leave the house twice a week to go get groceries, and you couldn't leave the house besides that. And the Colombians, I don't know if you know, if you've been to Latin America, specific Colombia, they're cleaners. People are spraying everything with bleach. And so I think this is probably more detrimental to the health than COVID. Everyone's spraying the food with bleach, the air with bleach. There, you had to put your shoes in puddles of I don't know what cleaner to enter stores. And I'm like, why are we cleaning our shoes? Like, am I going to lick the shoe? Like, for me, it was like crazy. Like, I was afraid at first, but then it's like, hey guys, like, after a while, it's like, you can't take out all the risk from life. At some point, you do have to keep living, and there's just risks, and some bodies are gonna be able to fight against the virus and some aren't. And it's not about the fact that you don't care about those people, but like, life does go on. And so it's a hard balance, and I understand, but
I like the idea of you can't take the risk out of life. And also, I like the idea of you mitigate your own risk. Like, at some point in time, it was very, I will mitigate your risks. Like, I'm on to you. And that kind of attitude always bothered me. Always. I'm thinking, okay, so let's say you think you might contaminate, or you're scared, or you feel that you have elderly parents. So then behave that way. Behave in a conservative way. But what does it have to do with the dude across the street? Like, why would I go out of my way and say, yo, buddy, you get in your house. I don't care. Do whatever you want. Yeah. And that social pressure, I would. And I was put in a position also to police my clients, which I hated. Yeah. I said to my wife, I goes, I don't want to be that guy. I'm a let live and let live kind of guy. Like, you do your business. I'm happy for you. I do my business. Now I have to say to the client, hey, listen, your mask, put it up, you know?
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, jeez, I'm glad we're not doing that anymore. Horrible times.
Absolutely. It's difficult when the government gets involved. And the silver lining of all of this is that it took more things virtual. It took things more online. So people that weren't exploring online education were now exploring it. And, you know, especially in learning anything, and especially learning how to dance, there's a time and place for class. And I think there's so much that like an online learning environment can give you. For example, you know, you're giving a good class in Montreal, but like, I'm at this level. And so I'm just looking for the little piece of information that you're sharing in this class that's going to help me get to the next level. And everything else went in one ear and out the other ear. And I'm never going to hear a class again. But if that class is recorded and those moves you taught or that sequence you taught is recorded, I can go back anytime, watch it slow, absorb it all. And so having that reference material, knowing the names of moves, it really expands your understanding and deepens your awareness of everything. So you can just go to these parties, have more fun, excel faster in your classes. Like they go together perfectly. It's not like, oh, I don't go to class, I just learn online. They're complements.
I asked my student what he thought, because there was a student that had been a member of my site for a very long time. And I asked him what he thought about, just what he thought about being a member of that site. Because I have no way to know, like, besides asking, right? So I asked him, well, what do you feel about it? He goes, it's like we're, like, privileged to have access to some kind of, how did he put it? Like, privileged knowledge. Like he said, I feel special to be able to access this. Like we were learning in class. That was one experience, but now I have this all knowledge that I can go back to all the time and look at the moves and thinking. And if the way he put it, I'm then thinking, oh, I'm glad that it gave you that feeling, because, you know, we work in a room in silos, and we barely can exchange like this with like-minded, like people that do this kind of work, right? And so we're sometimes, we 3 months alone, you know, working on projects. And when you get that kind of feedback, sometimes people tell us, sometimes you go out of your way just to know, what are you missing? I want to know what you're missing, because I feel I want to create stuff for you guys. If I'm just creating for my head, who cares? You know, I don't even have perspective of what it is to feel like. I remember how I feel when I started, but not that much, you know. I'm here for you guys, so tell me. If you tell me you need a move like this, I will give you a move like this, and I'll be happy. And I know it will probably answer other people, because you had that question the same way you were talking about how you started material, like you're answering questions, you're answering. And I think that's the best way. Sometimes I rack my brains for nothing, honestly. Like, it's all there.
It's true. And like, There's so many limitations of a classroom environment. You can only say so many words in 60 minutes. You can only practice so much in 60 minutes. And so it's important to understand, like, what are the pros and cons of a class? Like, what are the constraints? And then what are the benefits? And then online, like, what are the benefits there as well? Because I've never gone to a class or, like, started a 3-month salsa progressive program, and the teacher's like, okay, you're here, you're going to end up here, and this is how we're going to get there. But that's so easy to show someone online. Here's lesson one, here's lesson 30, and here's what we're gonna learn from there to there, and here's the names, and here's the categories, the shines, the partner work, the musicality, the this and that. And so it's just like, wow, because it's a different medium, you can learn and absorb in a different way, and it helps on both sides. And going back to what you were asking about, like, how much of the content do I just kind of, like, rack my own brain for? You know, remembering what was my experience like as a student versus asking the students, like those things that, like, oh, like, I wish I knew how to find the beat faster. Like, those things that were, like, the biggest pains, like, those are, like, ding, ding. Like, I know for sure everyone has that question. But then, like you said, a lot of the time the students have all the answers. It's like, hey, like, what are you struggling with? Like, I'm going to ask you, because maybe I didn't quite struggle with that because my history is different. I had a little bit more dance experience before. I played the piano or something like that. And so I didn't have that problem, but, like, you have that problem. And because you have that problem, there's probably a bunch of other yous in the world. So yeah, look to your students. They're giving all the gold.
I wanted to know, because that's something also related to YouTube. How do you deal with, let's say, trolls, negative comments? How do you get them? How do you take them personally, or how do you? I'm just curious.
Great question. It's a psychology is so interesting. I've been pretty lucky. I don't get too many trolls, which I feel super blessed. But I think there are some people where, like, you'll put a salsa video up and it's someone great, like Patrick and Scarlett dancing, and you'll get comments like, "This is not salsa, Puerto Rico," in all caps, or something, and you're just like, bro, like, what do you even mean? Like, it's like, oh, these are robots, they have no feeling. And you're like, actually, like, these people win championships. But, like, you don't need to write that. Like, I think the best response most of the time for trolls is just like, ha ha ha, like, LOL, like, just laugh. Like, don't give the power to them. Just be like, it doesn't matter, because, like, you don't want to have a conversation with those people, because this is a big waste of time. So I think laughing trolls off is the best thing to do. Kind of putting them off guard. Like, you can play with them if you want, but don't get sucked into the vortex of negativity. But interesting enough, I did make a video on, like, what's the difference between on one and on two. And I was specifically talking about dancing to the counts of 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. So dancing a tiempo is what you'd say in Spanish. And there was a lot of people that responded, because dancing on two to one, two, three, five, six, seven was popularized by Eddie Torres. And this is pretty common knowledge, but a lot of people are like, Eddie Torres doesn't even know what he's talking about. Like, he doesn't even dance this way. Like, and you're just like, okay, guys, like, even though, like, I've been around the world and, like, people are dancing that way there in Korea and you know, here. And you're like, okay. And there's actually a YouTube video of Eddie Torres teaching this. One, two, three, five, six, seven. And here's how you step. So you get people saying all sorts of things. And I, in some ways, it's kind of good because you're like, oh, I need to check myself. Like, am I sharing incorrect information or whatnot? Because I think, number one, it's important to remember, like, hey, I'm not a salsa god. Like, I'm not even the best in the world. And even if I wasn't the best in the world, like, I can still make mistakes. Like, just because someone has a YouTube channel or an Instagram account and they're sharing things, it doesn't mean they're sharing correct information. So you should never take anything at face value. I hope nobody ever takes what I say at face value. I hope it gives them, like, points of reference so they can dig in and investigate themselves. And if I say something that's wrong, I hope someone comments and says, like, in a non-trolly way, hey, dude, like, I think you, what you said was, like, incorrect and blah, blah, blah. Like, actually, I just posted a video recently about a bunch of different timings that you can dance on. And I was talking about dancing on three, because a lot of people are like, what, dancing on three? And yes, people dance on three, and they have in the past. It's not as common anymore. And what typically happens these days is dancers trying to dance on one might end up dancing on three because they're connecting with the cowbell. And a lot of Latinos you'll see here, they never took a dance class, so they're not counting one, two, three, five, six, seven. They're just hearing something in the music and connecting with it, which is totally fine. There's nothing wrong with that. And they end up dancing on three. And then someone responded to this video and was like, hey, like, you kind of made it sound like everyone's dancing on three by mistake, but actually, like, dancing on three is something that was really common before, and there's origins in Changui and blah, blah, blah. And I said, like, hey, like, I think his name is Robert. Like, Robert, thanks for reaching out. Like, can you please email me? Like, I'd love to talk more so I can get some sources and dig in. And by the way, I didn't mean to make it sound like everyone dances by mistake on three, but I'll do better next time in the way I communicate. So I think it's good just to kind of be open to that.
Man, I guess that was that's an intelligent interaction. But sometimes, you know, I would. It happens once in a while, but I just want to pause the ones that affect me, like the ones that really make me doubt or like, but it took a while for me to get a hang of what kind of attitude exactly what I'll get, right? For the first time when it happened, I had a video of my friend doing a belly dance, one of the greatest dancers here in Quebec. And the video went viral. And so the misogyny, you call this, like, it was crazy. So I had to raise my filters to a point where if you say shit, you're already barred. It's like, screw that. You know, all the breasts, tits, and stuff. I couldn't handle it, because I remember that time it was my friend. That's what bothered me most. So then when I was doing videos with my wife once or twice, I did one video. Then I was really thinking, man, if somebody says something, I'm going to strangle the person. But I'm thinking, it's always the same scenario when a client calls and says, yeah, I spoke to that lady, and that lady ended up being my wife or somebody I really liked. Like that kind of attitude, the bravado, it feels that I always think, in what space is somebody in his brain when he's sitting in front of a video that somebody created that took him 20 hours and just goes, shit and fucking, and you know, and I'm thinking, why? Like, and I know there's a part also that of people saying, well, thank them because they give traction for you on YouTube and it's good for the algorithm. So I had a guy answer me this way. He said, well, it's all good for me. The haters, they give me more algorithm points and stuff like that. So I said, okay. So you see it a very practical way.
Right.
But it's very hard not to take it personal. For me, I think there's maybe 10% left of sometimes I would, like, one time the video I did about like the fitness thing, the guy said, is it supposed to be funny? And man, I wanted to write, you know what I wanted to write? I said, only if you have joy in your heart, buddy. But I didn't write anything. I said to myself, don't write anything. Yeah. Give yourself a 24-hour rule. Wake up the next day and go,
smart.
Okay. So I'm not going to write anything, delete. But it's hard because we're creators and we like to create stuff and help out, and it's not it doesn't come from a bad place. And when you get bashed openly like that, it's challenging. And I think it's in a way therapeutic, because I kind of slowly remove myself from the effect that it brings me. Like, I always ask myself, why does it bother me that much? I always dwell on that question, because what did it hit in my body? Like, why I feel this tension now and I want to murder somebody?
I mean, it makes sense, because you're pouring your soul into something. And I mean, we're emotional and we're social beings. So when someone says something negative about something that was positive for you, or that you thought was going to be positive when you put it out into the world, like that hurts the heart. And I think it's important to, like you said, I think it's a great rule. And like, hey, this is triggering me, this is bothering me, I'm going to step back for 24 hours, whatever it is. And I think this even works in like a relationship. You can speak to this more than me. I'm not in a relationship. You're in a marriage. If you're having kind of this scuffle, like, hey, let's just take a 10-minute break and then see if we still feel the same way in 10 minutes. You calm down, like, everything's so different. And Gary Vaynerchuk talks about this a lot. I don't know if you know Gary Vaynerchuk or follow him. It's like, when people are spitting that venom at you, like, it's because they're not in a healthy place. They're not in a good place. Like, being critical of someone in kind of like a positive way, like, hey, I think you can do this better, is one thing. But like, hey, you effing suck. Like that, or like, hey, this is a waste of time. Why'd you make this video? It's like, why are you watching the video? This obviously isn't for you. Like, let's be logical here. So it's important to realize, like, these people are either in an unhealthy spot, like, they don't feel love, they're not feeling good about their lives. So giving that empathy and compassion back to them is like, hey, they're not feeling in a positive place like me. Unfortunately, this feels damaging to me, but like, yeah, just not taking it personal and being like, hey, like,
the ha ha ha, I'll keep it. I'll put ha 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 everywhere now. Fuck that ha ha ha.
No,
because
so funny.
It Thank is. You. No, you explained very well. It's more a reflection of them, because I always think, what kind of a headspace you have to be in front of a screen destroying people? Like, what's, you're not well, right? You have a lot of time on your hands. You could be doing some fun stuff. You might be able to do your own channel. How about you do your own channel? Always think about, man, it's so hard to do, even if I don't like something. I have a friend, amazing choreographer. Sometimes she does pieces, I don't like them, I don't say anything. Once she does something that hits me, I go, ah, that's amazing. But I'm not going to critique her out of the blue without her asking me anything. Yeah, you know that move you just did. You know, like what is this? Like, I'm God sitting here. I know everything. So it's a very good point. Almost an hour, my friend, if not an hour. I want to finish with a philosophical question.
All right, let's do it.
Salsa or bachata?
Salsa or bachata. I think there's always going to be something you connect more with, and that comes from probably your confidence level or love with the music. So for example, I've practiced more salsa. I've never really done like bachata training or anything like that. So I connect more with salsa at the moment because I feel more comfortable and I can express myself better to salsa music. I would love to get there with bachata, but I'm not there yet. So I enjoy salsa more. Love all of them. And I would love to do kizomba and zouk as well, but I'm not there yet.
There's an argument right now because the bachata is booming like crazy here in Montreal for the past 5 years. And I had a guy explain to me, there's many reasons for that. And one of the reasons that I don't know what your thoughts about it. He says it's because bachata is easier than salsa.
How would I answer that? I think if you're not counting central bachata, if you're just talking about kind of like modern bachata, like taking the salsa turns and kind of putting them in bachata, I think it's simpler. It's slower music, number one. The music is less complex. And it's easier to find the beat, number one, which is really helpful for beginners. And it's slower, so there's a bit less pressure. And so the moves are going to be easier to execute. So I think on that level, it's going to be easier. If you start jumping into central bachata, that's going to require a lot more technique, a lot more subtlety, a lot more understanding of musicality, etc. So I think if you start going into central bachata, I'd say like, hey, it's not worth comparing. It's a bit different. There's more technique involved. But on one more comment I wanted to make is everyone's kind of diving into central bachata right away. And I wish that more people were doing traditional bachata first and, you know, adding the turns, kind of modern, and then going to the sensual body rolls, etc.
There's a lot of women there's a lot of women walking around right now with a lot of spine pain and a lot of complaints because guys are destroying them. A lot of things a man is killer.
Yeah, and not only because like it's probably uncomfortable for a lot of follows, but also just like from a foundational level. If you start learning like sensual bachata, but then a traditional bachata comes on, you're like, oh, I don't dance that. It's like you dance bachata, but you don't dance bachata. Like, I think it's always good to understand and appreciate the culture from the ground up, like understanding what created what I'm doing now. You know, if you like your own little variant of it. Yeah, that's just my two cents though.
Listen, amazing conversation. I really enjoyed your perspective. I really enjoyed the way you go about things, about your business, about Dance Dojo. Now that I know the philosophy behind it or your mindset or how you go about, I have even more respect for you, for your work and what you do for salsa. I am a fan also, okay? And I recommend your work to my students and I'll keep doing it. And I'm happy that you're doing it for another part of the world. And I appreciate your time, Robin. And I don't know if you want to throw out there how people can reach you or how can they get in touch with you and what they can get involved in your space.
Sure. Ilias, first of all, I just want to say like thank you so much to you. You're a very bright light in the community and I've watched you over the years and you stay super positive. And I think that's so important because there's one thing is learning salsa or learning dance. But another thing is feeling like safe, a part of a community, enjoying the people you're doing all of this with. Because really, at the end of the day, like life is about people and being a community. So I think you're a great community leader. So I'm proud of you for that. And I really admire you for that.
Thank you, boss.
And your last question, how can people connect with Dance Dojo? Easiest way is thedancedojo.com. Go straight to the website. If you're curious about the online lessons, you can try them completely free for a week. We're also on Instagram, and you can find us on Facebook, The Dance Dojo. There you go.
Well, thank you very much, Robin, and I hope to talk to you soon. We can do this this yearly, maybe from another country.
Sounds good.
I'll follow you around the world every year. We do a meeting around this time. I would love to talk to you again, for sure.
Oh, for sure. Well, we'll have to cross paths in Montreal sometime.
That'd be cool.
You're a great interviewer, so I really appreciate it. This was fun. So thank you.
Thank you, my friend. Take care.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Ciao.